give this talk. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Perfect. So in this presentation, we'll be focusing on cooling effects on two main challenges related to CO2 storage. One is the risk of CO2 leakage due to damage of the Caprock sealing capacity. And the other one is related to induced seismicity due to fault instabilities. And I will not only focus on sedimentary formations, but also I would like to extend this the possibility of storing CO2 in deep volcanic areas. I would like to acknowledge my collaborators that have contributed to this work. So I would like to start by highlighting the fact that CO2 storage has not led to any major earthquake to date. The maximum magnitude has been always lower than magnitude 2. Here you can see two examples. One is in Salah in the Algeria desert, where they were storing CO2 in this orange formation, and you can see that the microseismicity was occurring below it. And in the case of the K-Tour, again, the maximum magnitude was 1.7, and most of it occurred in the crystalline basement. So we will see during the presentation why there is this tendency of the seismicity occurring below. But first, let's take a quick look to how seismicity is induced. So let's imagine we have a fracture of whatever orientation. We have a stress field that tends to close the fracture in the normal stress. And there will be fluids in the subsurface filling the fracture, in principle water, which has a pressure. So what actually is closing the fracture is the effective normal stress. And thus this fracture is going to remain stable as long as the tangential forces acting on the planes of the fractures are lower than the mobilized friction times the effective normal stress. When we inject a fluid, we are inducing an overpressure that tends to open this fracture. And also we are inducing cooling, especially close to the injection well. And this is reducing the total stresses. So both actions are having a reduction of the effective stress. So our Mohr cycle is displaced towards failure conditions. And if we keep injecting, eventually we may reach the failure surface. And in this case, we would have a microseismic event. As you can see in the figure, due to the roughness of the fractures, the fracture aperture increases, and this enhances permeability. So this microseismicity is beneficial if it occurs within the storage formation because we are going to have an enhanced injectivity, but we want to avoid it to occur in the caprock because we may create migration path through which CO2 could leak. So we have seen that there are three factors controlling induced seismicity. We have stress of state, overpressure, and cooling. So now let's take a look how they look like in CO2 storage. So let's start by the stress of state. Here you can see a literature review on several sites for different rock types in which I plot the maximum versus the minimum effective stress. And these lines represent the mobilized friction. So for values higher than 0.6, we are in criticality of stress. This means that we are very close to failure conditions. And as you can see, the red triangles correspond to crystalline rock. And you can see that most of the crystalline rock are in critically stressed conditions. However, we are going to inject CO2 in sedimentary rocks. And you can see that most of the sedimentary rocks are below the criticality of stress. And in particular, I've indicated these blue dots, which correspond to sites where CO2 has been injected or is planned to be injected. So in most cases, you can see in the Mohr cycle, in general, we have criticality of stress in sedimentary rocks and crystalline rocks, which are very stiff. But usually it's not the case in sedimentary formations. And this means that we can induce some certain overpressure before we reach failure conditions. But it's very important to characterize in each site what is the stress of a state, because there are some sites like these ones, for instance, in which sedimentary rocks are critically stressed. So we should be careful about that. Now let's take a look how the pressure evolves when we inject CO2. So if we inject in a saline aquifer, CO2 induces a two-phase flow. Initially, when CO2 is injected into the wellbore, it will start desaturating the pores around the injection well, and as a result, the relative permeability will decrease. So this means that at the beginning of injection, we have a region around the injection well with reduced permeability, and this is produces a barrier, and this is why initially when we start injecting CO2, as was the case in Ketzin and many sites, what we see is a sharp increase in the overpressure when we start injecting. But once the CO2 fills the pore around the injection well, the relative permeability increases towards one again. And because of the low viscosity of the CO2, CO2 can flow very easily inside of the storage formation. And as a result, unless we have a low permeable fracture fold that is causing a barrier to flow, what we are going to see is a constant or more or less constant pressure with time, which facilitates pressure control. And this is unlike what we observe when we inject water. When we inject water, what we observe is a linear increase of the pressure with the logarithm of time. So in this case, CO2 injection facilitates pressure management. And then the third aspect is cooling. As Nicolas was already explaining, we usually have cooling around the injection well. In this figure, you can see in the y-axis the gas pressure and in the x-axis the temperature of different injection sites. So in the wellhead, what we see is that we are different conditions of CO2, but at the downhole, where CO2 is pressurized due to the column of the fluid on top, and it also gains some temperature. But if we compare to the reservoir conditions, what we observe is that apart from the pressure built up that we need to push this CO2 into the storage formation, we observe a cooling, which can be significant for deep formations like Cranfield or at high flow rates like Insala. And this cooling induces a thermal stress reduction that may affect the Caprock. And for this, we were doing these simulations in which we consider a normal faulting stress regime. We inject in through a vertical well. In this formation here, we have the storage formation. We have the Caprock on top and a basalt below. And after 2 years of injection, you can see that the CO2 plume has a radius of around half a kilometer. And if we look to the cooling front, it advances much behind of the saturation front. So now there is one order of magnitude in difference. And this is because the cold CO2 needs to cool down the rock before it can advance. And you can see that most of the cooling front advances through advection inside of the storage formation, but also the lower portion of the caprock is cooled down due to conduction. And what we were looking also is to, we were considering a plastic, viscoplastic constitutive loss, both for the caprock and the reservoir. And what we see is that the rock gets damaged, but only inside of the storage formation within the cooling front. So you can compare these two figures. They are at the same scale. The rock within the storage formation that was cooled down was undergoing shear plastic strain. So this means small micro seismic events that may increase the permeability. But the cap rock was not damaged. So this is in favor for maintaining cap rock integrity. So to understand why this happens, this is because within the cooled region, we have cooling in all directions, both in the horizontal, but also in the vertical. And this thermal stress reduction is proportional to the stiffness of the rock and the cooling. So in the vertical direction, we have a reduced vertical stress within the storage formation, but the overburden is constant. Still, we need to satisfy the stress balance. So what we need is a stress redistribution around the cooled region, which is similar to tunnel excavation. And actually, what we get is an increase in the horizontal stresses in the lower portion of the caprock that tighten the caprock. So if we take a look to the Mohr cycles to better understand this, what's happening, we see that in the storage formation, due to the cooling, the stress, the reduction in the thermal, in the horizontal stress, brings the stress of state to failure conditions. But in the caprock, due to this increase in the horizontal total stresses, the deviatoric stress decreases, and as a result, we maintain stability in the caprock. Nonetheless, this was for a normal faulting stress regime, but if we look to other stress regimes like strike slip or reverse faulting, the situation is not that beneficial, especially for strike slip. We maintain the deviatoric stress, and the thermal stress reduction brings the stress of state closer to failure conditions. So this means that we need to assess cases specifically what are the effects of cooling on the caprock capacity, on the caprock integrity. And just in the last part of my presentation, I want to introduce a new storage concept in deep volcanic areas. And why we are proposing this is because it reduces the risk of CO2 leakage. So in this plot, you can see the density difference between water density and CO2 density. So in CO2 storage in sedimentary rocks, we are in this zone around between 10 to 20 MPa, between above the 30 degrees Celsius. And in this situation, the CO2 is buoyant, so it tends to float. But if we go to higher pressure above 22 MPa and high temperatures above 375 degrees Celsius, water is in supercritical state. And in these conditions, the CO2 is denser than the water, so it will tend to sink. Here you can see a simulation of how the CO2 plume evolves. We are injecting through a vertical well, and as the CO2 plume is injected into the formation, it sinks, and it finally advances preferentially through the bottom of the storage formation. This is a new concept that we have proposed very recently, but of course there are some risks that we have to explore yet. And one of those is the effect of cooling, because at these depths, the magnitude of cooling will be larger than in deep saline aquifers. And here I show you an example of the effect of cooling. This is for a simulation of enhanced geothermal system in a supercritical conditions in a deep volcanic area. We are injecting in this well, and after 25 years of injection, what we have is this cooled region here. And in the background, you can see the changes in the Coulomb failure stress, so positive values. This means that the conditions are more unstable, and blue values is when the stability improves. So similar to what I was explaining for sedimentary rocks, this cooling of the around the injection well, what is causing is an increase in the horizontal stresses above and below the cooled region, which in a normal faulting stress regime increase the stability both below and above. But on the sides of the cooled region, there is an extension of the, so a decrease in the horizontal stresses. And if we have, for instance, a fall here, we are going to instabilize it. So cooling may induce seismicity in the long term as the cold region increases. So this is something to look at if we go to these depths and high temperatures.
Can you wrap up, Victor, please?
Yeah, sure. So just to conclude, the take-home message would be that CCS remains a safe option to reduce CO2 emissions. We have seen that cooling-induced stresses do not necessarily damage the caprock. We have also seen that in general we are getting low magnitudes of the induced seismicity, and this is because of the favorable stress conditions and also because of the easy to control CO2 pressure. And we have seen that the crystalline basement is critically stressed, so it's recommendable to have a low permeable formation below the storage formation to prevent a direct connection, hydraulic connection between the storage and the crystalline basement. And I just propose a new storage concept that increases the storage options for CO2. And I'd like to finish with a positive message saying, encouraging to store CO2 underground to enjoy the blue sky again. Thank you for your attention.
Great, thank you.